Welcome to Module 8 of Point Set Topology course. So in mathematics, the study of objects always goes hand in hand with the study of appropriate functions between them. Like when you are studying vector spaces, you will take linear maps. When you are studying groups, you will take group homomorphisms. Right, like this, when you studying metric spaces, we started with continuous functions, epsilon delta definitions. So we want to extend that definition to encompass all topological spaces now. Okay, so the new definition that we are going to make always should encompass the older definitions. Okay, that must be the motivation of keeping this, and it should give you more. So that is the whole idea. So let us make this definition first, namely of continuous functions between two topological spaces, x1 tau 1, x2 tau 2 are two topological spaces. A function from x1 to x2, that is a set theory function, it will be said to be continuous. Okay. So it will be called continuous function provided inverse image of every open set in tau 2, namely in x2, should be open in x1. So v is in tau 2, f inverse of v must be in tau 1. Okay. So for the first time, you may see that why things are happening the other way around. But soon you will realize that this is most natural way to define. It is not open sets go to open sets. Inverse image of an open set is open. That is the most natural thing. There is a concept which says open set goes to open set. That becomes a subsidiary concept which is not so important as continuous functions. Okay, so there is another one also, so we will come to that one later. This is the correct thing in terms of epsilon delta definitions of our metric spaces. So let us see how that is true. Okay, so that will be justification for making such a definition in the case of topological spaces. This tau 1 and tau 2 are just topological spaces. They might not have come from any metric. But suppose they come from a metric, then you have two different definitions. One is for this one, whatever you have given just now as topology. But there is already something continuity coming from metric definition. So what we want to say is these two things are coinciding. Okay, so that is the next theorem here. Let x1 d1 and x2 d2 be two metric spaces. Take a set theory function from x1 to x2 as usual. That will be a continuous function in the topology tau d1 to tau d2 here. Now these are topological spaces. If and only if, as on metric spaces xd1 to x2 d2, it is continuous. Namely, there it is epsilon delta continuous for every point. Given any point x belonging to x1 and an epsilon positive, there must exist a delta such that d1 xy less than delta implies d2 fx fy less than epsilon. So this is, I am just recalling, I am not making another definition here, of course. So this is the epsilon delta definition for a function between metric spaces. It is equivalent to the continuity of the same function on the corresponding topologies induced by the metric. Okay. So once we prove this one, there will be a full justification for this definition. All right. So let us just prove this one, which is not at all difficult. Assume that f from x tau d1 to tau d2 is continuous according to the new definition. Okay. Take, now I want to prove it for epsilon delta. So take epsilon, epsilon point is given, x is given, epsilon is given, right? Look at b epsilon of fx. That is an open subset V inside X2, right? This B epsilon fx is a member of tau D2. So F inverse of that must be inside tau D1. So in tau D1, it is open. But now, look at here, I have taken fx here. Fx is a point here. So in the inverse image, X will be there. Therefore, x is in f inverse of v, and f inverse of v is open. So it follows that by the definition of the disk topology that there is a delta positive such that the delta ball around x, okay, this is an open ball, is contained in f inverse of v, right? Because f inverse of v is the union of open balls inside this metric space tau d1, in metric space d1. All right, so it must be such things. B delta of x must be considered f inverse of v. Now, d1 of xy is less than delta implies y is in b delta of x. Right, d1 of delta xy, d1 of xy less than delta means this y is inside here. So y is inside f inverse of v means f of y is inside v. F of y inside v means what? Look at this one. This y is in v delta of x, and hence f y is inside v. F y is inside v means d2 fx fy, the distance span must be less than epsilon. One way is done. Conversely, start with any v inside tau d2, we have to show that f inverse of v is open, namely it is inside tau d1, is what I have to show. So to show that this is inside tau d1, take any point x inside x which is inside f inverse of v. That means what? Fx is inside v. But v is open, fx inside v means you must have a epsilon positive such that B epsilon of fx is contained inside V. Therefore, there is a delta positive such that, no, that is a epsilon delta definition as in the statement. That means what? Difference between x and y is less than delta would imply fy is inside this open ball. Okay, so choose such a delta. Then f of B delta of x is inside V. Therefore, B delta of x is inside F inverse of V. So this is true for every x. F inverse of V is open inside x1, namely tau d1. It is in the element of tau d1. Okay, go through this proof carefully. So here I have used the fundamental property of tau d1, tau d2 that around every point inside an open set, there is a ball around that which is contained inside that. So this is the property I have used here. Okay. Okay. Now, one remark here is, unlike for the metric spaces wherein we have the notion of uniform continuity, we don't have such uniform continuity concept in topological spaces. Okay, there is no such notion, except you have to work harder. Namely, we will do that later on, remedied for some smaller class of topologies. which are not necessarily metric topologies. If it's a metric topology, of course you have. Okay. We need to put extra structure, uniform structure on that domain and codomain, what are called as uniform structures. So they are not ordinary topological spaces, but satisfying more conditions. Okay. So that will not be done in this course. It is not a main thing, it is a side topic. So we will not have time for that. Analog of theorem 1.19 is true in the general case of topological spaces as well. And it's easier. This 1.19 is nothing but theorem on composites. Okay. So this remark was as a negative thing. That is all. This remark was somewhat in the negative tone. But rest of them will be now very happy things, everything positive. So composite of continuous functions is continuous, is theorem 1.19 for metric spaces. The same thing is here true. And the proof is much easier now. See, it is much easier. What you have to do? There is a function here, the function here, the composite is there, right? Take an open set here, inverse image open here is what you have to do. Inverse image here under G first comes here, but that is an open set because G is continuous. Now you take the inverse of that, that will be the full inverse image of under GF of inverse. Okay, GF inverse of U is G inverse U and then F inverse U. Right? This is the set theoretic property. This is purely set theoretic property. So U is open. This is open. This is open. F inverse of that is open. Okay. So it is easier to show that composite of two continuous functions is continuous in the case of topological spaces. All right. Therefore, this also proves now whatever we prove for metric spaces. You see, we need not have proved that. We have used that. Okay. A continuous function x1 tau1 to x2 tau2, now arbitrary topological spaces, okay, said to be a homeomorphism. This is the word I am going to use now. Okay. What is homeomorphism? F is a bijection. And its inverse is also continuous. F is a continuous function. It's a bijection, therefore it has an inverse. That inverse is also continuous. Okay. Suppose you have a homeomorphism from one topological space to another one. Then the two topological spaces are called homeomorphic to each other. This is homeomorphic to this. Okay. From the previous theorem, it follows easily that being homeomorphic is an equivalence relation on the collection of all topological spaces. One thing is clear by the very definition, homeomorphism, inverse is also homeomorphism. There is no need to work because it's a bijection. Inverse is a bijection. Inverse is there. Inverse is continuous. F is continuous. So F inverse of inverse is F itself. Therefore, if there is a homeomorphism like this, F inverse will be homeomorphism from the other way around. So symmetry comes. Any topological space is homeomorphic to itself because identity map is always continuous and bijection of both ways. From the same topological space to same topological space. Okay. Identity map is always continuous, no problem. Therefore, reflexive transitive is what you have to do. Transitivity is precisely this theorem. F, X, this one is homeomorphic to this one is homeomorphic to that one, x1 to x2 to x3, so x1 to x3 is that. Okay, so homeomorphism is a function being homeomorphic, they are topological spaces. So on topological spaces, this is an equivalence relation. Okay. So this equivalence relation is of profound of interest to us. Any two closed intervals, so here are examples. Any two closed intervals consisting more than one point. You see, closed interval could be singletons. So you should avoid that. Singleton is a singleton. If there are more than one point, then that closed interval, no matter what it is, all of them are homeomorphic to each other. This is the statement. Similarly, any two non-empty open intervals, may take one empty, the other non-empty, they will not be homeomorphic. Okay, empty set is never bijectively set to any other set. Okay. So any two non-empty open intervals in R are homeomorphic. So there are many homeomorphisms actually, but you can find something which is very nice, namely of the type fx equal to ax plus b. It's a linear polynomial, polynomial of degree 1. So when is this a homeomorphism? It must have an inverse, right? So it's very clearly that A must be non-zero, B could be anything. Okay, then you can write down its inverse. So these are linear maps. Okay. For any non-empty open interval, is homeomorphic the whole line itself. The interval is bounded. The whole real line is not bounded, but still they are homeomorphic. So this is what one has to see, and there in several ways you can see it. Standard maps are the following. Look at fx equal to x divided by 1 minus mod x. So where I am going to define? From the open interval minus 1 to plus 1 to the whole of R. Suppose I have proved this one homeomorphic. Then I know any open interval finite like this will be homeomorphic to any open interval AB by this method. So all of them are homeomorphic to the whole of R. That is what I get. So how do you get this homeomorphism? Very easy. Look at this inverse. It is nothing but x divided by 1 plus mod x. Okay, you can compute it. The standard method, put y equal to this and solve for x in terms of y. So you may have to, because there is a modulus, you may have to make two different cases, x non-negative and x negative. Okay. So if x is positive, what is it? This is 1 minus x. Then you can y equal to x divided by 1 minus x. You can rewrite it in terms of x equal to something, in terms of purely in terms of y, and so on. So that is the way to check this one is a homeomorphism, easy way. Directly write down the formula for the inverse. Okay. Here, another one from trigonometry, tan pi by 2 x. X is ranging from minus 1 to plus 1. So the domain, when you put minus pi by 2, it goes to minus infinity. Plus pi by 2, it goes to plus infinity. 0 goes to 0. So it is a strictly monotonically increasing function from minus 1 to minus 1, 1, 2 to 0, 1, because you can look at its derivative, blah, blah, blah. That's why it's a trigonometry, some calculus you may do, okay, to show that it is. And then you can show that it's strictly monotonically increasing. Graph will be like that, going like that, right? So both minus 1 plus 1 go to plus, this goes to minus infinity, goes to plus infinity. Those points are not there. But the entire, all the open, the whole values in R will be taken. It's a surjective map. Because 1 goes to infinity and minus 1 goes to minus infinity, everything in between must be there by intermediate value theorem. There are so many different things you can use. So why this is homeomorphism, I'm telling you. That is why you can write tan inverse. There's just a justification for writing tan inverse. Okay? given any topological space X, you can look at all self homeomorphisms from R to R, from R2 to R2, and so on. Take any topological space, take a map from X to X, which is continuous, and bijection, inverse also continuous. Look at all them. You compose them, okay, that will be again a homeomorphism. You take the inverse, it's again a homeomorphism. Identity map is always homeomorphism. These three things together, what do they make? They make a group. That's the definition of a group. In fact, the group of homeomorphisms and automorphisms and such things, they are the harbingers, they are the originators of group theory. Okay, the self-homeomorphism forms a group. Unfortunately, this group is too huge. Unlike in group theory, in the beginning, you get to know, you know, small, small groups or nice groups like integers and so on. Okay. So, in general, study of this group, namely HX, that brings out the geometry inside X. Okay. In fact, people have gone to the length of defining geometry as the study of the groups of homeomorphisms, groups of automorphisms, groups of isometries, and so on, or subgroups of these groups. What is happening in this group? That is the geometry. Okay. So this group is quite huge. Let me elaborate what is the meaning of this quite huge a little bit. Okay. Such a study cannot be completed in any semester course. Okay. So let us look at some examples here. Take all linear maps T going to lambda T plus mu or A T plus B, like AX plus B I have written there. Lambda and mu are real numbers. Lambda must be not zero is all that you need to say that this is invertible. Now I am writing the inverse also. Inverse will look like S going to S by lambda minus mu by lambda. You can check it that this is the inverse of lambda. Okay. So they are all there. They are all homeomorphisms of R with itself. Given two pairs of real numbers, A1, B1, A2, B2, okay, A1 less than B1, A2 less than B2, B2 is A, or the other way, whichever way you want. So you assume that there is always a linear map alpha which sends A1 to A2 and B1 to B2. You just write down a linear map AX plus B, alpha X plus beta, and solve for alpha and beta by putting this condition. So that is still standard stuff, solving two simultaneous linear equations. So that will give you the formula for this function itself. Okay. Namely, this alpha T is now the function which takes A1 to B1 and A2 to B2. Check that there may be some errors here. You should check that. Okay. So if there is a B1 is become B2, that is not all that crucial. You have to check that and correct it if at all. If it's correct, it's fine. So what is claimed is that you can solve for this alpha T something like AT plus B. I am finding this A and B here. What is the condition? AI should go to BI. A1 should go to B1. A2 should go to B1. That's very straightforward. All right. Once we have done that, this is already geometry. See, I can find a map which is a bijection, 1-1 mapping, 1-1 correspondence from any interval to any other interval. Right? That is the meaning of this one now. Okay, but there is more than that. Okay, more geometry is coming up. Take any set of real numbers, finite set of real numbers, put them in an order. Take another with the same number, put them in the order. The order is important here. when you are taking only two of them, even the order was not important. You could have mingled here A1 going to B2 and B1 going to A2. That's also possible here. But here it's important that you should have the same order. Then you can find a homeomorphism F which takes A1 to B1, A2 to B2, An to Bn. Okay. How do you get that? I will explain it to you. I don't want to write down the full formula. If you want, you can write down. Actually, I have written down that also. But first, I will explain it to you. These are A1, A2, A3, A4. This is B1, B2, B3, B4 here. Okay, I want A1 to go to A2. Means the graph of that, the point will be here, right? This is the graph. A2 should go to B2. So point will be here. A3 will go to B3, point will be here, like that. So these points I have done. Then I have joined them by straight lines. Because I know there is a linear map which takes AI to BI. AI plus 1 to BI plus 1. Concentrate on each interval here first. Two at a time, right? Take two at a time. In the order, namely, so this interval, that interval, that interval. First, get a map which takes this one to this point and this one to this point. So this is this map and this is the line segment. Here there is no condition, so extend the same line segment. Don't disturb it at all. Here there is no condition beyond that. Extend that line the same way all the way from the last line, but in between join them by line segments determined by those points. This is a graph. You can write down the formula now. No problem. So in each AI to BI, there will be a different formula. Okay. So once you know this, you can write down. I have written it down here. You can check it. There may be some errors here. Some AI may be missing. AI A2 may be missing something. I may be become I plus one, all that you have to check. Okay. So this is not a big game. You have to know, of course. But what you should understand is how to get this one. All right. So I have defined the function in three different ways, but this middle one gives you all the in between intervals. The last two gives you what you have to do, namely, don't worry, this part you have to extend it as if you have defined here. Similarly, whatever function comes here, you extend it here. In between, use the, from I to I plus 1, use this formula. So that's what I have done here, okay? Fi of t. Various Fi of t's are there, right? We send Ai to Bi. So I have taken this fi is function f of ai to bi and fi of ai plus 1 to bi plus 1. For each fixed I, there is an fi. If you change I, of course they will change, right? That is correspond to these having different slopes here. Okay. So, indeed, here is a theorem from real analysis which characterizes all elements of HR, the homeomorphisms. What are all the homeomorphisms? This is a characterization. It may not be much helpful, but it is quite helpful. A function f from R to R is a homeomorphism if and only if it's continuous and strictly monotonic. Strictly monotonic because you want what? You want it to be one-one mapping, right? Like that. Okay. It may not be onto, but you put onto also, it will be homeomorphic onto R. Otherwise, it will be homeomorphic onto the image. Okay. So I am using this word here homeomorphism slightly more general here, that's all. See, I have not put ontoness here. I should put ontoness here also. Okay. Yeah. So let us stop here today. And next time we will do more on, not just on R, but now R power N. That will be the next topic. Thank you.